Good evening, everyone, and welcome to RBC Foundation Presents the Walrus Talk Social Innovation. My name is Shelley Ambrose. I'm the Executive Director of the Walrus Foundation and the publisher of the Walrus Magazine. It's great to be back here in this beautiful Kerner Hall at the Royal Conservatory in Toronto on the traditional territory of the Mississaugas of the New Credit. This has been a place of cultural exchange, conversation, and social innovations for thousands of years. So you're in good company. Some of you know how this goes. Hands up if you know what the Walrus Magazine is. Yay! And this is the part where you don't lie to me. Hands up if you subscribe. Not bad, we're getting better at this. Okay, I'm gonna speak to the rest of you at the end. Hands up if you've ever been to a talks before. Welcome back. And the newbies, shall we welcome them? Then most of you who have been here before, this is likely know this, so this is for the newbies. The Walrus Foundation is a national charitable nonprofit. We have an educational mandate to create forums for conversations on matters vital to Canadians. Those conversations include the Walrus Magazine, all kinds of daily content at thewalrus.ca, and on stages like this from coast to coast to coast. Most of you who have heard me talk before know that the walrus is a northern animal, large, hard to ignore, irascible, somewhat smelly, and it has no wings. No left wing, no right wing, and neither do we at the Walrus. We are an independent entity with no owners and no one point of view. We are governed by a national board of directors, including here tonight our board chair, Helen Burston, and board members Bruce Bennett and Dick O'Hagan. They, like you, are part of the Walrus community, which means that you are fearless, witty, thoughtful, and curious about Canada and its place in the world. The Walrus Foundation is supported by circulation and advertising, corporate sponsorship, and charitable donations, including our founding donor, the Chalkers Foundation, and from Chalkers here tonight, Jim O'Reilly and Preeti Varma. Without them, no Chalkers, no us. That's just sort of how that works. There's no way we could do the work that we do without Chalkers and all of that support and without partners like the RBC Foundation. RBC is one of our longest standing and most beloved partners. They are a lead donor in our Optimistic Canadians program, and they do a lot for us and a lot for people in places across the country. Social innovation is at the core of their community investment, whether it's emerging leaders, youth health, arts and culture, water, or so much more. Please join me in welcoming the RBC Foundation's Director of Youth Donations, Noah Aiken-Clar.
Thank you very much. Where I work within RBC, senior leadership has given us a very clear mandate to tackle some epic problems, whether it might be the environment, as mentioned, the arts, or in my case, youth, and to create real social impact. And for me, that in particular means unlocking the potential that youth have to thrive and to drive the economy, and really all of Canada. But we know that if we're going to make lasting social impact, we need social innovation. We know this. So what is that, really? Social innovation, arguably, it's about changing social systems, disrupting them, disrupting the status quo. Maybe it's about the process. Maybe it's a social process. It's collaborative, it's collective impact, it's multiple sectors and multiple partners, unusual suspects. Yeah, but maybe it's just a fancy way of saying new ideas for making the world a better place. I'm not really sure all the time. I mean, I know what I think, but I think you probably don't care as much about what I think as you do about what our speakers think. So, without further ado, I just want to say on behalf of RBC how pleased we are to support the Walrus. How committed we are to supporting thoughtful conversations about Canada and society and how to make the world a better place, and that we look forward to innovating with you in the future. Thanks again.
Thank you, Noah. And as I said, the talks would not be possible without the RBC Foundation, nor would they be possible without each one of you. As we always say, we know how busy life can be. And if you weren't here, there wouldn't be anyone for the Walrus Talkers to talk to. So it's very important that you are here, and we want to thank you for your time, those of you here and those of you joining us by live stream. I'd also like to thank our national partners at Shirk, Shaw, Inspire, and Amia Aeroplan. They have helped us now produce 65, this is our 65th Walrus Talks event that we've produced across the country over the past 5 years on topics as varied as vice, climate, human rights, destiny, energy, water, the Arctic, philanthropy, spirituality, and much more. So tonight, as you know, our topic is social innovation. And as Noah said, what is social innovation? Social innovation, as they say, is a novel solution to a social problem. It does mean thinking differently. And because our sponsor tonight is a bank, I'm just going to tell you a little tiny story. So there's a businessman, he's complaining to a friend about how dim-witted young people today are. He said he'd tried the same scenario every day for weeks with one young employee who day after day kept making the wrong choice over and over again. "Watch this," said the businessman, calling over the young employee. The businessman took a quarter and a loonie out of his pocket and asked the millennial to choose the quarter or the loonie. The millennial chose the quarter. The businessman said, "See?" and walked away. The friend asked the millennial, "Why on earth do you keep choosing the quarter?" The millennial looked him in the eye and said, "The day I choose the loonie, the game ends. No more quarters." So here's how the Walrus Talks works. Each of our esteemed speakers has 7 minutes, and they know this. Each one will come up and introduce themselves. There is no MC. You have a program in your hand. It's in speaker order. If you flip it over, their bios are on the back, and we trust that you can follow along. You will see and hear 7 speakers in a row, and our hope is a little over an hour from now, we'll have a lot to talk about in the post-talks reception and out in the world. So just before I let them get underway, I'd like to thank each in advance. Thank you to curator and community organizer Wanda Nanibush. Thank you to the president and CEO of the McConnell Foundation, Stephen Huddart. Thank you to the Godfather of Good, David Love. Thank you to the CEO of the Center for Social Innovation, Tonya Surman. Thank you to Ashoka, emerging innovator and co-founder of the Public Accessory Commission, Kevin Vuong. Thank you to Evergreen Canada's Geoff Cape. And thank you to physician, scientist, innovator, and educator, Julielynn Wong. And thank you for coming. Let us begin.
Miigwech, Anin, everybody. I want to acknowledge Canada as Indigenous land from coast to coast that we share with everybody who's come afterwards. I also want to tell you a little bit about myself. I'm Anishinaabekwe from Beausoleil First Nation, and I'm Wolf Clan, which means I'm into strategy and protecting my family. And my name, the first part, Wanda, means wanderer. And the last part, Nanibush, comes from Nanibojo, which is our trickster. So I'm a wandering trickster. So you can choose to trust me or not. What I'm going to do, like a good trickster, I'm going to solve all of our problems in 7 minutes. Well, 6 minutes and 12 seconds. What we need is to have a clue, or to clue into children, land, language, water, and women. For me, this is what Idle No More movement of land defenders and water protectors was all about, is all about. What so many of us continue to work on in a variety of ways, from working in our territories, to curating exhibitions, or to making art. Children, I'm gonna start with children. And that includes youth. Children are the center of the Anishinaabe community. We act and think in ways that protect them. See, I normally don't read, but I've got 7 minutes, so I thought I should. But I hate reading, I just like talking. We act in think in ways that protect them for many generations by protecting the world they will inherit. We also nurture their self-worth, strength, curiosity, and independence. They are assisted in finding their gifts, and they're obligated to find a path to sharing and using those gifts. Children are wise, like elders, because they are closest to spirit. What I think of spirit is it's the fundamental creative force of the universe. They have less blocks to their imagination. We are born with thought, emotion, and body knowledge, and together their health and proper use feeds our spirit, and in turn the spirit feeds them back. This country has robbed us of our children for over 150 years. Historically through the Indian residential school system, something my mother survived, and today through the child welfare system, something I survived. There are more kids in care today than when residential schools were mandatorily attended at their height. I can tell you for a fact that racism, a lack of understanding the impact of residential schools, and what I call the post-colonial trauma stress disorder, our version of PTSD, the utter lack of preventative services, addiction treatment, or services to help parents be better parents, these things are at the root of this massive removal of children from our homes. I was pulled from my mother's loving but traumatized embrace by police when I was 5. I was lucky because she went to court and fought to make sure I wasn't adopted out to a white family. Technically, I am actually part of the 60s scoop, which started in the 60s and ended in 1985. After many First Nations survivors of residential schools fought to make sure more generations weren't removed from our communities, there was a law passed in 1985 that meant First Nations children, if removed, had first to go to a First Nations family. I moved back to my reserve by request in 1985. I was lucky because I had grown up with my family, they were in care with me, and my culture and my connection to my land. But I still got the PTSD. The main reason many kids are removed is poverty. That poverty has been implemented as part of the colonial project of Canada. It has everything to do with the wealth our land has given to Canadians. The price of Canada's wealth has been the expense of our land, bodies, and potential. Two things to learn and implement from this are to see the payments that go from two First Nations, not as handouts, but as restitution for land theft and lost income, and to stop using them as a political weapon. When First Nation communities assert their right to govern themselves, these payments that cover the fundamental and basic needs of a community are held back until the community complies with government legislation. We fought for control over our children so that we would not do a bad job with poor resources. So what we need is First Nations solutions to these problems, and for part of the justice aspect of reconciliation is about properly resourcing education, child welfare, which means buildings, curriculum, all these things coming from an Indigenous perspective, so that the one thing that has been tried for, assimilation, or what we call gradual genocide. So in order to actually end that and for the apology to have real teeth, then these kinds of solutions have to come within our own culture so that we can raise our children as Anishinaabe in their own land. And currently we're standing on Anishinaabe land. And land is central to our identities and to the wealth and economic and political sovereignty of any nation. So returning land to our communities means that the land currently held in trust becomes part of our, under our control. Getting rid of the Indian Act does not have to mean assimilation. It can be self-determination if it's Indigenous-led, and we take Indigenous title to the land and the treaty process seriously. We also have Section 35 of the 82 Constitution, which recognizes and affirms existing treaty and Aboriginal rights. This should not be decided by bureaucrats, but in a nation-to-nation equal discussion sitting across from each other at the table, what those rights are and what they mean. We keep people poor so they can't negotiate as equals because they need too much. Our lands, in being returned, actually give us a basis for wealth creation, much like Canada has had. I include water with land. Water is the land's sustenance. Both need each other to survive, and we need them to survive. All right. I'm stopping, I promise. Both need each other to survive, and we need them to survive. Women in my culture are the protectors of the water, and we stand up everywhere around the world so our children may drink her in the future. That's it.
Good evening. My name is Tonya Surman. So, what the heck is social innovation? We've heard a couple suggestions. New ideas for a better world. A systems change that alters the way that we do things. Solutions that put people and planet first. A wind in the sails of the new economy. The answer is yes to all and much more. But herein lies the problem. Systems change, as we've heard, is super complex, and as a result, inaccessible to most. And we really do need everyone to be a part of the solution. So what do? Our work at the Center for Social Innovation has been focused on trying to solve that challenge, and we think that we might have one small little contribution to help find that answer. Salad. I know. Salad. We actually think that salad might be a part of the solution, and specifically, Salad Club. I know I'm up here and you're thinking she should be saying something way smarter than this, but the truth is that we think that we've got a particularly little insight from the power of salad. At CSI, every week in every location, we perform a ritual called Salad Club. Salad Club is the perfect embodiment of the work that we do and how we create the conditions for social innovation. How do you do it? And you can do it too. Number one, you invite anyone to bring two items from their fridge to contribute to a salad bar. You meet in the kitchen on a given day at a given time and you start preparing food together. And then three, you eat, you share, and you talk together. What do you get? A revolution that starts in the kitchen. A potluck with potency, and edibles with impact. More specifically, what you get is people getting out of their seats, away from their computers, and talking and eating with people that they may not usually talk with. Wow, I actually lost my place. So where did it all begin? In 2004, a small group of us began a social experiment to better understand how to create the conditions for social innovation emergence. We know that social innovation requires new ideas and thinking, that it has to start with how we think about the very space that these ideas emerge from. As one of the first co-working spaces in the world, we have been trying to redefine work, to evolve new models of collaboration. We are exploring how to get people to really work together. We wanted to break down silos and even thought that we might be able to fuel a movement for change if we could get people to start working across difference. What we have learned provides some important insight into the potential of community to transform our systems. Here's our theory. If we're able to build a culture of innovation, one that will be able to fuel a sustained flow of systemic changes capable of positive social impact, we need to build intentional ecosystems for these ideas to flourish in. Through our little experiment, we've learned that you need to do three things to make social innovation happen. One, you need to create the space. Two, you need to animate the community. And three, you need to create the conditions for emergence. By create the space, I'm referring to a beautiful container designed for collision, whether that is a building, a salad bar, or convening people together into a single place and moment, like tonight. Number two, we need to animate the community, and by that I'm referring to the artful facilitation of people, fostering of connections, reducing the friction, and enhancing social capital, trust, and belonging that compose the loose connections of a community. By create the conditions for emergence, I'm referring to the ideas, the collaborations, and solutions that happen at the intersection between challenges, people, and ideas, all of which are putting the sails, the wind in the sails of social innovation. So how does this relate to Salad Club? We create the space by inviting people to come together in a kitchen with the intention of preparing and eating together, co-creation in action. We animate the community by guiding a conversation with the intention of social impact, sharing our day, our challenges, and our solutions with each other. We create the conditions for emergence by ensuring that it is permeable, intersecting, and curious. We create a culture that is creative, scrappy, risk-taking, and solutions-oriented, built on hope and possibility. With all these juicy little outcomes, all from an emptying your fridge, conversations start, people learn, banter, exchange, connections are made, co-founders are found, projects and solutions are fostered, but most importantly, trust is built. This is community, social capital, where innovation emerges in and amongst the needs, opportunities, self-interests, and intentionalities of people who are working on real issues for a better world. Almost 13 years later, it's working. We are now home to over 1,000 organizations. 86% of our members have collaborated with one another, and 71% have done business with one another. We operate and support 6 purpose-built spaces in 192,000 square feet. We created the community bond and raised $3.6 million to buy 2 buildings with the power of 300 citizens and some absolutely leading-edge foundations. We now have a charity to advance social innovation. Our community generates over $250 million in revenue annually, and our community creates over 250 new jobs a year. Our members tell us that they have shared ideas with one another and that these collaborations have led to real outcomes. Like Jane's Walk being dreamt up at CSI Spadina and now scaling globally. Like the first climate change law practice emerging when 2 lawyers reconnected in the space. Like Mark from Building Up, offering extra capacity of the people he was training to help Luke from the Stopgap Foundation to build ramps to make our city more accessible. Like climate solutions, social finance, community health, city planning, meaningful employment, and so much more, CSI's members are changing our communities each and every day. So what does this mean to you, and what does this mean for the world? To transport these ideas, this learning, to the rest of the world, we're going to need to leap forward and to take even bigger risks. It means we need to create spaces capable of tackling the biggest challenges we face. What if our cities were designed for innovation? Our living rooms, our parks, our malls? What would innovation look like then? It means we need to animate community by growing larger communities with facilitators capable of facing difference head on and meet it with patience, authenticity, and love. It means we need to create the conditions for emergence by bringing powerful intention to how we support the social change process. We will need to build healthy cultures in all workplaces built on belonging, authenticity, and meaning. I believe that how we connect and what kind of culture we create will be a key determinant in building new ideas, products, and new systems. To get there, we need a new culture that fosters the world that we want, an innovative, inclusive culture that puts people and planet first. And like Salad Club, it will include everyone.
Good evening. I'm Stephen Huddart. Dear Prime Minister, we're writing to you from Walrus Talks Social Innovation in Toronto, also known as the traditional lands of the Haudenosaunee and Mississauga North Credit, in the era of reconciliation with Indigenous peoples. Reconciliation is social innovation, and innovation is an Indigenous value. As Senator Murray Sinclair said, As Senator Murray Sinclair said at the 2015 Indigenous Innovation Summit, innovation is not just about new things. It's also about bringing the past into the present to address our current situation. It was a hopeful day, September 25th, 2015, when you joined 150 world leaders to proclaim the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, the Global Action Plan to reach a sustainable and equitable future by the year 2030. Today, the world is in a very different place. Just when we most need concerted action on issues like climate disruption and international migration, populism, cynicism, and insularity have trumped the political agenda. In the face of such formidable challenges, though, Canada has something new to contribute, our growing capacity for social innovation. You understand that social innovation's purpose is to create a more sustainable and inclusive society by changing the mindsets, institutions, and systems that we live within. In your mandate letters, you directed several ministers to develop social innovation strategies. But in the year since you sent those letters, there's been some progress, not as much as we'd hoped. And social innovation practitioners haven't been very effective in telling our side of the story. Our situation reminds me of Leonard Cohen line, "The door is of love, they budged an inch, but nothing much has happened since." So with 2030 just 14 years away, I want to propose four big ideas to move us forward. The first is to organize bold public challenges. Public challenges send a signal that we're going to attempt something great and everyone is invited to participate. And credit where credit is due, the government has announced that it will launch a Smart Cities Challenge next year to generate and reward ideas for innovative and inclusive urban infrastructure. But our most widely used public challenge platform is actually better known outside Canada than within. Grand Challenges Canada focuses on improving maternal and child health in the developing world, and by 2030 aims to have saved 1 million lives and improved 30 to 40 million more. So in the spirit of reconciliation, why not create Indigenous Grand Challenges Canada? And may I suggest a topic? How do we ensure that every Indigenous child who is entitled to one is provided with a Canada Learning Bond and thus their share of the $1.4 billion in unclaimed funds that were supposed to ensure that every child has access to post-secondary education? The second big idea is to launch 1,000 social innovation labs. SI labs, as we call them, are like design studios for solving complex challenges. They delve deeply into an issue, convene diverse stakeholders, and enable us to see the systems that we're part of in order to then create and test ideas for improving them. Give me three examples. City Studio involves hundreds of students in six universities and colleges working with City Hall to advance Vancouver's Greenest City Action Plan. Also in BC, In With Forward runs a lab with three community living organizations to improve the lives of people with developmental disabilities. Together, they created Kudos, a social enterprise that offers a catalog of free experiences from volunteering in a pet store to visiting City Hall to anyone who is bored, stuck, or just curious. Winnipeg Boldness is an Indigenous-led social innovation lab. It documented the barriers that are preventing low-income families from obtaining Canada Learning Bonds, and that led Mayor Bowman to create the Winnipeg Promise, a city's commitment to ensuring that every eligible child gets a learning bond. Now, as a result, Winnipeg Health Department provides financial literacy training to low-income families, and the province is looking at removing the $30 cost of a birth certificate. To collaborate on complex challenges, we need to move from occasional consultation to sustained and creative commitment. Working with partners like Waterloo Institute for Social Innovation and Resilience, Mars Solutions Lab, and Innoweave, we're beginning to launch labs with foundations, charities, universities, and cities across the country, and we would welcome government's involvement. Idea number three is to create centers for useful evidence. To get the most out of public challenges and social innovation labs, we need to simplify current research into language we can all understand. The UK Cabinet Office does this with its network of 9 What Works centers that summarize what is known and not known about issues like aging well, community economic development. Sharing evidence this way increases public support for change. It drives policy innovation and makes better use of public and charitable funding. It also fuels investment and entrepreneurship. And we don't have to duplicate the efforts of the What Works centers because their work is available globally, and ours could be too. Idea number four is to create a P4 finance agency. Expanding on the P3 concept, the public-private partnerships that fund infrastructure, a P4 agency adds the fourth P, philanthropy. Grants to early-stage innovations can create the conditions for investments in solutions. Uniquely, philanthropy can make program-related investments where losses are categorized as grants. And as a sector, we have $60 billion in endowed assets. But most importantly, we bring creativity and civic energy to solving complex challenges. A P4 agency would stimulate innovation in the public service, bring new dynamism to the social sector, put us in a renewed relationship when meeting the UN Sustainable Development Goals needs an all-out effort. The Economist's 2016 Global Social Innovation Index ranks Canada 3rd after the US and the UK. With recent events in those countries, we'll be number one soon. Seriously, in the midst of mounting challenges, social innovation affords us an opportunity to advance reconciliation, pluralism, and sustainable prosperity. To conclude, we're sending you one of the foundational texts in social innovation, published 10 years ago, but just as relevant today. It's called Getting to Maybe, How the World Has Changed. I hope we can work together to write its next chapter. With best regards, Canada's social innovation community. Thank you.
Good evening, my name is Geoff Cape, and I'm the CEO at Evergreen, and I've had the privilege of being involved with Evergreen for 25 years, and so my point of view around entrepreneurship extends really through the amazing experience I've had to be involved with a platform, an organization that effectively is a platform for innovation for others and for me. The work at Evergreen revolves around one big idea, and it's really about the future of our cities and how we think about our cities. The original goal of the organization 25 years ago was about integrating nature into the design of cities and really transforming the experience of our cities, how we engage in behaviors and enjoy the surroundings of the way the city experience plays out for us. The phenomena that's in play right now around cities, though, is breathtaking. The current population globally is that roughly half of the world's population lives in cities, 3.5 billion people of the roughly 7 billion on the planet. Over the next 50 years, there's an expectation that that's going to double, that we'll see roughly 7 billion people living in cities in 50 years. That will be a transformational moment. It is one that's in play right now. It has impacts on every imaginable situation, whether it's climate change, the tensions, political tensions, economic disparities, et cetera. So the way we manage cities over the next 50 years will be a life or death decision and the way we make lots of little decisions, a life or death game, I suppose, or very serious challenge for all of us. The way we make sense out of it here in Canada is what we can control. Canada's 86% of Canadians live in cities. We're one of the most urbanized countries in the world, and by some definitions, we make the best cities in the world. And so I see us with an opportunity to be global leaders in this particular space. When Evergreen began, our work was looking at the way urban sprawl defined the landscape in cities. On a more micro level, it was really about the way children's school grounds were being designed. They really were not engaging in diverse landscapes. There was no integration of nature in these spaces, and they were not creative in any particular way. So our early projects were really about animating these spaces, integrating nature into them, bringing creativity, creating spaces for children to interact and build and create and innovate, in a unique way in every single school. There are 16,000 schools in Canada, and we see the opportunity for every single one of them to be fundamentally different in the way they're designed, but to engage students, engage children in the actual design process, in the process creating innovation, building an innovation culture in Canada through children and their participation in the design of the space around them. What emerged for us, though, as we developed these relationships with schools across Canada was working relationship with cities, working relationship with different levels of government, working relationship with corporations, academics, and others. And we built this network of partnerships across the country that begins to feed into this role that Evergreen was emerging for ourselves, was building for ourselves as a convener and a broker and a facilitator of change in cities. Beginning with schools, beginning with school children, but building from that platform into larger landscapes. Many of you might know of our work down at the Brickworks, Evergreen Brickworks. It's been an enormous success in the way that it's transformed an old factory into a space that now is really about big, bold ideas for cities. It began as something very traditional in the way that a factory produces brick and builds cities through the digging earth out of the ground and literally producing buildings from it. We understood that that historical relationship with city building was an opportunity for new ideas, and keeping the gritty fabric of that old building was important for how it might set up the platform for new ideas for cities. And in the valley, this amazingly unique oasis has emerged where many people come to the landscape in the valley, come to the farmers market, come to the kids' camps, and learn about themselves, learn about the city of Toronto, and learn about a variety of ideas from across Canada and around the world. The bold new steps that we're taking as an organization right now is to really recognize that this landscape, this site we have, is more than just about our focus on ecology, our historical work. What we really want to dive into and what we have been pushing hard on for the last 3 to 4 years has been a bolder strategy focused on the breadth of urban issues, urban infrastructure issues, climate change issues, and the idea of changing the way we think about how we build cities in the future. Is if we continue to build cities for the next 50 years the way we have for the last 50 years, we'll be in a very, very difficult spot. So as we moved into this space and changing our organization's mission and mandate and really evolving our role as innovators, we moved quickly into a new subject area. We moved into mobility. We hosted a large-scale session and series of sessions over the course of about a year and a half, bringing the city and the region together around mobility and transportation issues, pushing for change around mobility, transit, and the way we manage our infrastructure for the transactions that relate to mobility in cities. That led to the organization's courage within the organization to advance new ideas, bigger, bolder ideas that were beyond the original focus of urban ecology. Organization currently operates as a platform for about 100 major projects. At any given time, there are about 100 different projects operating within the organization. Through partnerships and through an array of staff at the Brickworks and across the country. The obvious one that many people know about is our focus on climate change and adaptation and resilience. We flood down at the Brickworks. Some of you might know that, but when we do flood, it becomes a really strong point on how important transforming our cities in relation to climate change is. So we're in the process of launching a climate change strategy around adaptation. We're leading some work right now across the country looking at civic commons, which is public space, and how we can think about our public space differently. We're leading an initiative in the city of Hamilton looking at transforming the downtown core and the waterfront and reinventing that city, removing the stigma that that city lives with and trying to find a way for it to reinvent itself and become a city of young, innovative thinkers. We're leading an initiative right now with others looking at laneways in Toronto, laneway housing in particular, and how we might transform laneways, which are these forgotten landscapes behind. There are 2,800 laneways in Toronto that are essentially the back alleys of many houses in the city. How do we transform these areas into innovation corridors where young people can experiment with architecture, can experiment with new ideas, where microenterprise can be created in garages, where housing can be created for children and grandparents? We're taking an historical program of Evergreens focused on schools called Learning Grounds, where we've worked with over 6,000 schools across Canada, and we're beginning to explore how we can take that existing platform of school and transform it into a network of innovation hubs, using schools, the 16,000 schools in Canada, as innovation hubs in their communities, where that school becomes not just a place for kids to go and learn, but where a place where students, children can actually interact with their communities and bring new ideas out into the larger community around them. Some of you might know about our work in the Lower Don and how we've been advancing a strategy to revitalize Toronto's ravines and how we can turn the Lower Don into Toronto's largest park, which really simply recognizes the fact that we have this incredible ravine landscape that we've forgotten and we need to reinvent them and connect the asset to the entire city so we can use it as our commons, as the city's commons. The big learning for me along the way in this work, because it's been an incredibly dynamic ride as an entrepreneur, as a social innovator, to have so many projects and so many different ideas constantly flowing through an organization, is that it's really fundamentally very messy. It's complicated, it's emergent, it changes, it requires people to be comfortable with ambiguity and chaos. It requires a certain person inside the organization. Evergreen now is about 170 staff. And the culture inside the organization is one where the staff enjoy, generally speaking, not all of them do, the chaos that people like me bring in on a daily basis. We certainly have a group of people who enjoy the creative process, the creative energies that are built through working across sectors with academics, with municipal governments, with industry, and the mashup of all those different ideas creates the excitement that gets them up in the day to come down into the valley. And for me, it's been an incredibly rich career of 25 years. I wouldn't have done anything different looking back. Somebody asked me today in a funny little interview, is there anything, any big mistakes you've made with your career? And it's like, not a single one. I mean, I've loved every single minute of it. It's been incredibly rewarding. And I guess one of my points in that is simply that this area of social innovation can be a career. It can be an incredibly rewarding career. And I encourage all of you who haven't explored this space to let your children know or adventure into it yourself. Thank you very much.
So times are tough. Tensions and inequality are growing. So what should we do? My name is Kevin Vuong, and I want to share with you the concept of how community benefit agreements that return the benefits of growth and development back to the local community can be applied to more than just large-scale infrastructure projects. How you can innovate procurement projects of all sizes, as well as the process of giving more broadly to maximize social impact. Because whether you're a philanthropist or someone who is working on procurement for an organization, a business, or government, we need only make small adjustments to the process that can dramatically increase your social impact. To illustrate what I mean, let's look at a public accessory that's commonly procured for communities, bike racks. If a community wants a bike rack, the traditional process is to go out and buy one, install it in the community, and great. They now have a new piece of bike infrastructure for their community. The challenge here, though, and the disadvantage in this traditional process of procurement is that they're often not sourced locally. This means the upstream benefits of jobs and training and the downstream benefits, like spending in the local economy, do not return to the community. This isn't too different from the philanthropic model of giving. Why don't we stick with the bike rack example? Under a traditional way of giving, you would gift a community in need a bike rack. And like before, they now have a bike rack. Also great. But just like before, we're not making the most of the procurement to benefit the community. There's a missed opportunity to do more. And that is in the process itself. In a process that is focused on maximizing social impact, the community would be involved in a project from end to end. The community would be involved in its design and identify the public accessory that they want and that they need. And then the community is trained to build it themselves. As part of this process, they gain training and experience in skilled trades. They develop important life skills and they build self-esteem, confidence in themselves. They also build pride and ownership in their community. This always happens. My grandma told me it would. So, you might be thinking to yourself, wow, Kevin, this sounds great, but does it actually work in real life? What does this really look like in practice? Well, I'm thrilled to tell you there's this incredible team of city builders, and Kevin, who have been working on this. And we've been working on exactly what I've described to you, to empower and train youth from Toronto's Lawrence Heights and Neptune community to build bike racks for their neighborhood. Now, for those of you who might be unfamiliar with the community, Lawrence Heights and Neptune is a Toronto community housing and United Way priority neighborhood. It is also one of Toronto Community Housing's revitalization communities, a large and long 25-year project. It includes demolition, and it will bring significant change to the community. There's upheaval. Upheaval, but also renewal. Some of the other challenges that the community faces include a lack of jobs, opportunity, and unfortunately, more recently, a summer of gun and gang-related violence. So how did this all come about? Well, it actually began with a phone call. A call from a Neptune resident asking, you guessed it, for a bike rack. And because I can't emphasize this enough, this is really important because it has to be a grassroots-led effort. So when the community asked for a bike rack, we had a unique opportunity to do something different. With Lawrence Heights and Neptune, we had a community that was ready and excited to get working. They were ready to build something incredible. Because Lawrence Heights and Neptune is an amazing community, full of youth and vibrancy. Yes, they have had a challenging summer, but we should not let that become the narrative of their community. They haven't, and so neither should we. So they ask for a public accessory that they need, and they also decide where it should be located. We began the community consultations with three designs for them to consider, and you see that at the bottom. But again, remember, it's grassroots-led, so the design here that we started with is different from what we actually came up with. And the design is very important because it reflects their community. More than just a bike rack, it's also art that tells a story of the neighborhood's heritage and values. And this is why the final design is that of a bridge, which is a hybrid of the branch design that you see in the bottom right and feedback that we received from residents. We're building bridges for the community, and bridges, pathways to jobs and training. We're just finishing the build right now, and I can't wait to show you when they've been installed. But until then, in a Walrus Talk special, here's a sneak peek of what it will look like when the project is finished. Unlike the traditional model, this community-driven approach ensures that long after the project is over, the community will continue to benefit from the innovative process, from the skills and training, and the pride that they will feel every time they pass by the public accessory that was built by them, for them, built by the community, for the community. Today it was a bike rack. Tomorrow it could be storage sheds, it could be picnic tables, or any number of projects. Infrastructure or otherwise, large or small. So the next time you're looking at making a gift or procuring something for your organization, your business, or a government agency, think about how you can innovate the process to make the most of the opportunity and maximize impact. Because you're not just helping a community in need, you're equipping them with the skills and the confidence to succeed. You're building a legacy of a city and a country that leaves no one behind. Thank you.
Good evening, brothers and sisters. My name is David Love, and I'm the godfather of good. And I want to start by commenting on my wardrobe. I'm going to talk tonight about innovation and fundraising, but some things about fundraising will never change. The first, go where the money is. I'll return to this later. The second, from the original godfather, and you can say it with me, folks, is make them an offer that they can't refuse. At the outset, I want to establish my philanthropic credentials. These are my great-grandfathers. On your left, my great-grandfather on my mother's side, an earnest stock boy who went on to spearhead the Toronto General Hospital. His name was Joseph Flavelle. On your right, my great-grandfather on my father's side, an athletic farm boy who built the first TB sanitarium in Canada. His name was William Gage. They were both knighted for their philanthropic work. Philanthropy, my friends, courses through my veins. I want to talk to you about innovation in fundraising, an art which desperately needs it because the stakes are high and because the old ways don't work. Innovation has so infinite potential to make our donors' dreams come true. And that's what philanthropy does. It inspires us to make ambitious, outrageous, inspiring dreams come true. Let's go back to my great-grandfathers for a moment. Sure, they contributed a lot of money, but they also raised boatloads of it. For the most part, they relied on basic human traits which served them well. Traits like guilt, obligation, peer pressure. They convinced their colleagues that they should give money away and be done with it. And it worked, and it still does, but not like it used to. Our donors today, bless them, and I dare say, I hazard I'm talking to you a room full of donors now, bless you, want, demand, and deserve more. Fundraising is being reinvented. Right now, down the street, about 1,000 fundraisers are getting together to learn to innovate at Canada's premier fundraising conference. I'm going to talk about four innovations which have changed the way we raise money to make dreams come true. The first innovation centers on you, on the millions of individual donors in Canada who contributed $9 billion in 2014. In the early 90s, I read a book called Relationship Fundraising by a charming young Scot named Ken Burnett. Ken's thesis was that fundraising was not about the organization or even the cause. It was about the donor. You can't imagine what a shock that was to me. A fundraiser not by choice, but because it was the skill I brought to my cause, healing the natural world on which we all depend. Being skeptical, I tested Ken's idea. Would I raise more money by talking about my donors? The answer was a resounding yes. When I talked about our shared values, when I told and invited stories, and when I thanked people quickly and passionately, World Wildlife Fund raised lots more money. So my first innovation in fundraising is to put the donor first. At the Agents of Good, we call it donor love. Today's best fundraisers find new, innovative ways to put donors first. It continues to transform fundraising from individuals. My second innovation comes from a horrible story. In 2013, 94-year-old Olive Cook committed suicide by jumping into the Avon Gorge in Bristol, UK. Olive was a lifelong supporter of many charities, killed herself because the charity literally hounded her to death. At the end, she was getting 260 begging letters a month. She told her family and close friends she couldn't cope anymore with requests for money, in the mail, on the phone, even at her doorstep. My friends, fundraisers killed Olive Cook. As a result, many are taking a new approach to their craft. Specifically, they recognize that begging letters don't work. Instead, fundraisers will work together recognizing the cumulative effect of what they do, and they will respect that the absence of no does not mean yes. The third innovation is in an audience is to channel. While much has been written about the internet's fundraising potential, it remained unproven until the Ice Bucket Challenge. No doubt some of you got coldly wet, and the results for ALS were stunning. Now others are trying to recreate this moment, and I wish them luck, but I want to touch on the heart of the innovation. It was that this simple gesture released a philanthropic spirit in people everywhere. My friends, we are born philanthropic. We are destined to make our dreams come true if we can think about others and not worry about whether we will survive. This spirit flows through us looking for a way out. The internet-driven ice bucket challenge let philanthropy burst out across the country. My last innovation still gives me goosebumps. Fundraisers live by a few simple rules. Do your homework, listen before you talk, and as I said a few moments ago, go where the money is. Over the next 30 years, we are going to experience a legacy tsunami. The upcoming senior generation are going to inherit lots of money, and they're going to give it, they're going to leave gifts in their wills to causes they deeply care about. The boomers, bless them, will create legacies, and new research will help us encourage these precious gifts. Dr. Russell James, a charming researcher at Texas Tech, is obsessed by what motivates donors to give. So he puts them into MRI machines and ask them questions about donating. This slide shows you his extraordinary result. When we think about giving to charity, the part of our brain which lights up is the part my great-grandfathers appealed to, the obligation part, the need to give back. But Dr. James was stunned to find out, but when we think about leaving a legacy gift, the part which lights up in the part of our brain is where we keep the stories of our life. It's the autobiographical part of our brain, not the charity part. It's the story of ourselves. The implications inspire me every day, and more research is coming. Innovation improves current reality. A better car, a better ice cream, a better toothpick. Innovation in philanthropy means philanthropy can be better. And that, my friends, is true. But philanthropy is not a car, an ice cream, or a toothpick. It is the anxious, ambitious, transformative investment in a better world, and it creates a fiery spirit. That spirit fills this room tonight, and as we leave, let's all recommit to philanthropy, to making our dreams come true. Sure, we can do better, but we're doing our best, and we're learning as we go. There's nothing we would rather do, and nothing our ailing world needs more. Thank you.
I'm Dr. Julielynn Wong. Canada has one of the best healthcare systems in the world. Today, we can deliver better healthcare by using technology to save lives, time, and money. I founded 3D4MD, a social enterprise which uses 3D printers to impact over a billion lives. We're building a digital library, like iTunes, but instead of songs, people can select and download crowdsourced, quality tested, 3D printable files that are lower cost and can be personalized. That are lower cost and personalized medical supplies that you can make on demand locally. 1 in 7 Canadians has a disability, and because of a shortage of skilled workers, many people with disabilities can't get assistive devices that allow them to participate fully in everyday life. We make award-winning 3D printable assistive devices that can be made on 3D printers in hospitals, public libraries, universities, schools, print shops, and people's homes. And this saves time and money for people with disabilities. Like this pink prosthetic hand we made for a Guelph girl that cost $25 to make. She was born missing part of her hand, and her parents can't afford to buy her a new prosthetic hand every year she grows. Or these 3D printed custom finger splints we made for a Toronto woman with cerebral palsy. Instead of booking and paying out of pocket for an appointment with a healthcare worker, now she can go to a public library, pick the color she wants, 3D print a replacement custom splint for less than $2 a piece, and not have to miss work. 1.4 billion people lack access to electricity. And in many remote places, simple medical items are expensive and can take weeks to months to arrive at a clinic. We've designed and tested a solar-powered, ultra-portable 3D printing system that fits inside a carry-on suitcase and can make a range of medical supplies on-site to save lives, time, and money. This is a replica of a custom finger splint we printed for a Toronto patient. It's made out of 25% recycled plastic drink bottles. Today, it's possible to take plastic waste, add fresh plastic, recycle this to create printer feedstock, and make medical supplies with 3D printers powered by solar energy. 3D printing can reduce poverty because having a 3D printer is like having a mini factory on your desktop. We were invited by the World Bank to teach students how to use 3D printers to start their own companies and build sustainable livelihoods. Astronauts can't take everything they need with them on a long space mission. We're scheduled to 3D print the first medical tools on board the International Space Station. We've made over 10 3D printable surgical instruments for astronauts and the 5 billion people on Earth who lack access to safe, timely, and affordable surgical care. With 3D printing technology, physical objects can be stored as digital files. This allows us to crowdsource innovative designs on an unprecedented global scale. And now anybody can be an innovator, because if you have an idea, you can draw it digitally using free software, and you can make it physically real by clicking print. So I founded Medical Makers, a global community of innovators, healthcare providers, and patients who make sustainable solutions to save lives, time, and money. Jody on the far left joined Medical Makers when she was 16. I taught her how to design and 3D print medical supplies. She's now a co-inventor on 7 pending patents. She's 17. This device measures two-point discrimination, a test of nerve function. It's very accurate and reliable. The problem is that it's very expensive. This is the device that most doctors use. A paperclip is cheap and convenient, but it's not accurate. So Jody used free software to make a 3D printable two-point discriminator that's shaped like a ninja star. This device is much more accurate than a paperclip and over 10 times cheaper than the gold standard device. Plus, the case is 3D printed, and we can personalize it with your name. The future is here. The future is now. By harnessing our collective creativity and compassion to make healthcare better for Canadians, we make medical solutions for patients we know, people we will never meet, and will continue to help people after we're gone. So join us. Together, we can do so much to save lives, time, and money. Together, we can make healthcare better for the 5 billion people who lack access to surgical care, the 2 billion people who live on less than $2 a day, the 1.4 billion people who live without access to electricity, and the 1 billion people who have a disability. In closing, this is my 3D printed Star Trek selfie made on a replicator. I hope you all live long and prosper, and may the Force be with you. Thank you.
Maybe she can 3D print me. And, you know, the road trips would be so much easier. Thank you very much to all of our talkers, Julielynn Wong, Wanda Nanibush, Stephen Huddart, David Love, Tonya Surman, Kevin Vuong, and Geoff Cape. Thank you all. Geoff, we at the Walrus, a startup really, we're only 13 years old, are also a bit familiar with disruption in the media world and otherwise, chaos, creativity, and excitement. This is, tonight is the final Walrus Talks of 2016. We've hosted 24 talks across the country this year with close to 200 talkers. And we are grateful to have shared rooms like this with more than 8,000 Canadians and had tens of thousands watching Walrus Talks online. If you want to see some of those talks while you're eating your lunch or 3D printing yourself, you can go backwards in time and watch more than 400 talkers now, free and on demand, at our YouTube channel, which is, our username is Walrus Television. The other thing that you can do is you can visit thewalrus.ca or Blair and Kaylin at the Walrus Lemonade Stand, where there is no lemonade, but there are Walrus things, in the lobby, and you can subscribe to the Walrus magazine. Why do you want to do this? Because it will save you time, it will save you money, it will prove your love of all things Canadian, it will prove your love of your community, and we actually believe it's hard to be Canadian if you don't read the Walrus. So subscribe, visit. And speaking of making things better and not waiting till 2030, although bold public challenges are good, we are involved in another thing. We're looking for great ideas to make Ontario better. We have partnered with the Lieutenant Governor of this province, Her Honor Elizabeth Dowd as well, to create the Lieutenant Governor's Visionary Prize for Ontario 150. She is looking for the most innovative young brains and public policy ideas from Ontarians under 35. The submission is an essay or a video on your phone of 800 words to solve a challenge that Ontario will be facing over the next 50 years as you see it, and what your solution might be. And we are going to have 6 public events across the province next September, and there will be prizes for these young visionaries. You can learn all about that too at thewalrus.ca. If you are one or know one, we would like them to submit, because these are the people that will be running the world very shortly. Now, I want to appeal to your sense of guilt and obligation, which is this part of your brain here, apparently. and say that we, two of our biggest supporters, have done something quite incredible for us and have committed $50,000 to a match, dollar for dollar, loony for loony, don't take the quarter. All donations received at the Walrus Foundation before December 31st will be matched dollar for dollar by Diane Blake and Stephen Smith, which is quite something. So if you're in the mood to donate, or if you're thinking about your legacy, that other part of your brain, you can also do that in the lobby. I think you've got donor cards with you. We accept cash, checks, credit cards, especially RBC cards, stocks, bonds, jewelry, art, property, everything except small children. And you will get a tax receipt. So just, I have one more thing to tell all of you, but just before I do that, I'm going to ask our speakers to up, and I'm going to let them go into the reception first so that you don't do that weird thing that you do where you trap them in the front row and don't let them move. So yeah, no, you go too. Off you go. Everyone else, please stick with me for a minute. So I'm very excited to tell you something about 2017. Watch this.
In honor of Canada's 150th birthday, the Walrus is hosting 13 talks in 13 fascinating places. It might look a little something like this.
Do you think Margaret Atwood should receive the Order of Canada?
Yes.
That's a trick question. She already has. Have you ever brought beer across provincial borders?
I have, yeah.
You know, that would make you a criminal? Get this guy! Are you in the 1%? What do you think of the state of Canada's police force?
Walrus talks.
The Walrus does talk. We are going to 13 provinces and territories in 13 weeks next year. We have been named a signature initiative by Heritage Canada, although they didn't know about this part. We're working in partnership with Rideau Hall and the Order of Canada because the Order of Canada celebrates its 50th birthday in 2017, and we are going to bring 104 talkers, 50 members of the Order, 54 youth leaders to stages like this across the country. These events are free. The dates are on our website at thewalrus.ca. All you have to do is reserve a ticket. We released the tickets a couple of weeks ago. Some of the locations are sold out or close to sold out, some are not. So I encourage you to reserve your seat for our Canada 150 tour as soon as possible. If where you would like to join us, Charlottetown, Whitehorse, Iqaluit, is sold out, we will be live streaming and CBC Radio will be broadcasting. So you can join us in lots of different ways. Now I'd like to thank RBC and everybody again, the team here at Kerner Hall, the Walrus event team, David Leonard, Kaylin Cooper, Blair Elliott, and Leanne Skippy Stepnow, and I hope that you will join us in the reception in the lobby. There is food and drink, including the Powers Knowledge Lounge, featuring samples by our friends at Powers Whiskey. So you can have the whiskey, you can have the wine, you can have a subscription, you can donate. And if you join us, there will also be great conversation because the truth of the matter is, you are the Walrus. Thank you. Safe home.